our stand. Let's thank our God tonight for another opportunity to be in His house. Hallelujah, Lamb of God. Lord, we come to You, God, with our hearts lifted up to heaven, our cups lifted up to heaven, God. Lord, our barrels lifted up, Lord. We ask that You would overflow them tonight with Your goodness, God, with Your love, Lord, and Your mercy, Your grace that endures forever. Help us tonight, God, to receive all that heaven has to offer tonight, knowing that Jesus is already here. Knowing He said, when two or three gather in My name, that He's there in the midst of them tonight. Move in a mighty way, Lord, in our midst tonight as we look to You tonight. In Jesus' name, let it be done. Amen and amen. Praise God. Come on, brothers. Let's do this one.
Amen. If you remain standing, we take turn to page 240 and sing that song, Victory in Jesus. Page 240.
Yeah.
tonight for every victory, God. Thank you tonight, God. As we look to you tonight, we walk in your spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated tonight. Man, we definitely have victory tonight in Jesus. I have no sad stories to tell you. We are winning.
Amen.
Winning right now, you know, it's even in outside. I mean, Sister Walls, we drove up to our place and we was like, wow, the snow is melting.
Yes.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Definitely now. We're winning like that.
Hallelujah.
Snow is melting in Wisconsin, is it already? I know I'm winning.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
But praise God. It's good to be back here tonight. In the service tonight, we are looking forward to what Spirit of God has for each one of our lives.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
Tonight.
Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to receive an offering as Brother Joshua Riedel will help us tonight. You give as unto the Lord, and the Lord will richly bless you. And all Christians,
amen,
born again believers,
yes,
saved,
hallelujah,
in the knowledge of the Savior,
hallelujah,
they pay their tithe and give an offering.
Amen.
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 Man, I have to tuck tail and say, not say that.
Amen.
But, you know, that's how God, I'm going to have a lesson tonight, but that's how God bless you.
Yeah.
If you believe enough to give of your finances, he will bless you. The Bible says he'll open up the windows of heaven. Man, God has some big windows too. I'm thankful for his many blessings, brother.
I love you, Father. Once again, we thank you for this time to be able to give to you on this Sunday evening. Now we just ask that you would bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for your giving. The Lord will richly bless you. At this time, Sister Walls and Sister Samson are going to sing as unto the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. But I've heard tender whispers of love in the dead of night. And you tell me that you're pleasing, that I'm never alone. Your good, good Father is who you are, is who you are, is who you are. And I'm loved by you, is who I am, is who I am, is who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers only. Cause you know just what we need before we say a word. Your good, good Father is who you are, is who you are, is who you are. And I'm loved by you, is who I am, is who I am, is who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, I'm loved by you. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord God.
You're worthy to be
praised. Amen. Praise
the
Lord.
Amen.
We serve a good God tonight.
Yes, we do. Amen. That's right.
This time, Brother Joshua Riedel is going to preach the living word of God to us tonight.
Amen.
Appreciate his life for the Lord, his faithfulness to God. Come on, brother. Take a look.
Amen. It is good to be in the house of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And I was thinking as we were getting ready and up here, and I was thinking about how much that I appreciate the family of God.
Yeah.
How that each and every one of us here tonight, we're all brothers and sisters. We all love God. And I appreciate the unity that is behind that. And I was thinking earlier about the power to break free and how God moves in men and women's lives. But if you want to be following along, I'll be taking my Bible reading out of the book Acts. It's going to be a little lengthy, but bear with me. Chapter 16, and we're going to read verses 23 through 34.
Amen.
Acts chapter 16, 23 through 34.
Hallelujah.
And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken.
Oh, yeah.
And immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed.
Yeah.
And the keeper of the prison, awake out of the sleep, seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And verse 31, they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that thou shalt be saved and thy house." And we want to preach on a little bit of a while of our title of a message, The Greatest Love Story Ever Told or Restoration.
Yes.
Pastor, would you please stand and pray for the message and messenger?
Heavenly Father, we're thankful tonight, God, for this gathering. Thankful, Lord, for your spirit that's here right now. We ask, God, that you, by the Holy Ghost, continue, Lord, to hide our brother behind the cross, make preaching easy, Lord, for him tonight. God, we ask that you would touch the very hearts and the lives of every soul that's here tonight. We ask this in Jesus Christ. Holy
name. Amen. Let me read one more time. This is my text, verse 30 and 31. And he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." And we want to look at this tonight, and we want to look at it in the aspect of restoration, and we want to look at it in love. And love makes the world go around. As each and every one of us look at our life, we can all relate to love. That's really at some aspects of why we're here in our life. It's because of love. Our mom and dads, they decided to get married, and they decided to have children, and they fell in love one day. They said, "We want to have children." And the whole aspect of love is just totally awesome. And as we look at salvation in our lives and the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did at the cross of Calvary, it's really all about love. That is the basic foundation in men and women's life. It's about love tonight.
Yeah.
Amen. Okay. And as we look at this night, without love, there would be nothing in our lives. But love from God is also different. It is a cost in Christ tonight. At 1 John, it says 4:19, we love him because he first loved us. And John 15 and 12 says, "This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you." And I'm telling you, When you get saved tonight, it's so easy to love. It's so easy to love men and women. We come into this church and we realize that black and white doesn't make a difference. It doesn't matter who's behind the pulpit, whether the man be black or white. If we're a Christian tonight, we love that individual. We love the men and women that are sitting in the congregation. We love the men and women that we go out and we invite people to church, and we don't look at people for what they are. Did you know God is colorblind tonight? Did you know that? When God looks at a man and he looks at a woman, he looks at their soul. He doesn't look at what it's on the outside. But men and women look what it's on the outside. That's because they're not saved. They're not born again, and they're not Christians. They do not have that love of Christ that's needed in their heart. Are you getting the point tonight? It's all about love. It's all about love. And when we get born again, when we accept Jesus Christ into our heart, that love is there each and every day. I can remember getting saved back in 1998, and I was a Marine down in Oceanside, California. And I really didn't know anything about God. I just went to church. And we grew up here in Wisconsin, and the church that we went to was very mellow, very dry, and very boring. I only went because my mom and dad made me go. And that was the only reason. And I know once I got done with Sunday school, I'd go over to Grandma and Grandpa's house. That's just really why I went. And I didn't know a whole lot about God. And I know when I went to church, it was the only reason I went to church was because I was tired of the man bugging me. So that's why I went to church. And when I went to that service, I had no idea what was going to happen. I had no idea really what the man was preaching about, what he was talking about. The only thing I understood is when he stopped talking about Christ, and he would tell me an illustration, because I understood the illustration because it related to my life, because I just didn't know a lot about God. But all I know is when I weighed myself down to that old-fashioned altar, and I went down there, and Reverend St. Clair Sr., he prayed with me for salvation. And I really didn't understand what I was doing, but I know when I got up, I was a different person. I was changed. When I got up, that weight was just off my shoulders, and I felt like I was walking on cloud nine. And God took all that hate out of my heart, and he put that love and that joy and that peace in my heart. It's about love. It's about Jesus Christ. It's about being born again. And God wants to do something in your life. He wants to make a miracle in this service. I don't know where you're living at, and I'm totally off my message. But it's a blessing, because God knows exactly what we have need of. That's what I like about the power of the Holy Ghost. I came here early. I got here about 5:10. And I stood behind this pulpit, and I had my message out, and nobody was here. And I wanted to get ready, and I felt the presence of God. Standing here like I am now. Nobody was out in the congregation, but God was here. God was wanting to move in men and women's lives, and he knew who was going to be here tonight, and he knew who was going to be listening online. And 200 years down the road, you never know, whoever is listening online will get blessed. And I don't mean that in a prideful way, because it's all about Christ. That's what it is. Each and every time we get behind the pulpit or we lift God up, it's always about Jesus Christ. But the reason why Paul and Silas were in jail was because someone got mad. Over in chapter 16, at verse 16 and 18, it says, "And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her master such gain by smooth saying. And same following Paul and us cried, saying, These are the servants of the Most High God, which shew unto us the way of salvation." Isn't that funny how the devil knows exactly what's going on? He does. This woman was not a Christian. And she knew exactly what Paul and Silas were there for and was broadcasting it to all those people. "And this did she many days. And Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her. And he came out this very same hour." So now they're in jail. Sometimes as men and women, we feel this way. Sometimes bad things happen. I was fellowshipping with a very good friend of mine the other day, and he made a statement to me that really kind of touched my heart and really stuck out. Now, I don't mean this in a bad way, but we were just talking in life, and we were talking in general, and he said, "You fail more than you win." And I got to thinking about that, and I was like, you know, in some aspects, that's really a lot of truth to that. And that sometimes in life, a lot of bad things happen to us. Sometimes we could find ourselves in jail, and we don't know why. Sometimes we could find ourselves in an aspect where I don't know how I'm going to pay my rent. And we don't know how this happened because this happened and that happened. But God is always on the scene, ready to bless. I remember living down in Florida, and I worked at a job where I got paid by what I did and not by the hour. And it's week three. And I don't have enough money to be able to pay the rent at the end of the month. And I would pray, God, I need this such and such amount of money. And at the end of the week, I had more money than what I prayed for. And it just got to the point in my life where I just knew that God was going to bless. All I had to do was just speak the words. God, I need this blessing in my life. And it got to the point where it happened so much that I didn't even worry about it anymore. I just knew that God was going to bless in my life. The key to victory tonight is to be thankful. To be thankful for the blessings that God has in our life. To be thankful for the car that God has gave me in my life. To be thankful for the job that I have. To be thankful for the children that I have. To be thankful for the house that I have. 1 Thessalonians says 5:18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Be thankful in our lives. Where would we be without Christ tonight? Where would we be? Would we be laying down in some gutter or somewhere? Would we be broken down? Where would we be? Only each and every one of us in our own mind can answer that. But Paul and Silas, they were thankful. As we read in our Bible reading, they started to pray and they started to sing. God knows how to get men and women free tonight. He knows exactly what we need of. And he wants to set the bondage that's in your life. He wants to set you free.
Yes.
There's something that as a Christian, sometimes as a brand new Christian, we kind of live in la-la land to a certain degree. And as we grow in the grace of the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, the light bulb comes on with certain aspects. And we realize that everybody is going through something. No matter who we are, no matter where we're at in life, everybody is going through something. And now sometimes it may be all the time. But God's going to bless and give it a break. But as we're preaching tonight, and God set Paul and Silas free out of the bondage of that jail, what bondage are you at in this service tonight? Is there something at your soul that's just really, really eating at you? Something that you just got to get out? As we preach tonight, I want you to get that out. And Jesus Christ wants to just get that out of your soul. Just lay it on the altar tonight and say, God, I am tired of this in my life. I want to get the victory over this sin. I want to get the victory over this battle tonight. It's the greatest love story ever told. It's through the power and the blood of Jesus Christ. And he wants to restore your soul tonight. It's all about Jesus tonight. John 10:10 says, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and destroy. And I come that you might have life and to have it more abundantly. Amen. That's what it is. It's more abundantly. Did you know that there is a sin of unbelief? Did you know that? Did you know that not believing is a sin? What did God just say? He said that they have it more abundantly. God is telling you that. God is telling tonight, he wants to set you free. The power to break free. That's what that sign says. The power to break free through love, through Jesus Christ. What's that bondage that's in your heart tonight? What's in your soul? What have you been fighting for years? Sometimes it's like that. Sometimes as brothers and sisters and men and women would be honest, 20 years goes by, it's still eating at them. But when are you going to learn how to love again? When are you going to learn how to love again? When are you going to just let that go? You know what it is. You know what's been at your heart. You know what it is when you're at work or when you're laying in bed at night and everything gets quiet. You know what you've been crying about. When are you going to learn how to love? You know exactly what that is. If you truly want to have that love in your heart tonight, it's Christ. It's always about Christ. In every aspect, it's about Christ. When we lift him up, he will bless in our life. 1 John 1:7 says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. He cleanses us from all sin. And sometimes people just don't want to let certain things go. Or sometimes we let it go, but as soon as we get up from the altar, we pick it right back up and we walk out the door with it and we get back in the car and we take it home. But he wants us to cleanse us from all sin tonight. Not just a little bit, but everyone and every aspect of it. And I was getting ready for the message tonight and I was so cranked up. I was just ready to go. I was sitting in service tonight and I was just cranked. I was listening to Pastor and I was just ready. I was just ready to go. I was so excited after I found out I was preaching. I was so excited I was shaking. I text Pastor Brown and I said, hey, Pastor Brown, I'm preaching. I'm preaching, Pastor. He texts me back and he was all excited about it. But it's just a blessing, and I was thinking about it. We're getting ready. And I was thinking about the blood of Jesus Christ. And I was thinking about how that each man and women, all we need is just a touch of this vitamin J. And just that vitamin J, what it does, just one drop, we put it on top of our head, and it just cleanses us from all unrighteousness, and it starts up here, and it goes all the way down the floor. And the thing of it is when Jesus cleans the inside out, the outside gets clean too. But do you need to be restored tonight? And the question is do you want to be restored tonight? I don't know about you, but I like cars. I like a lot of cars. I like old cars. I like new cars. I like Porsche. I like Ferrari. I like Lamborghini. I like BMW. I like Mopar. I like Chevy. I like a lot of them. But I was thinking about restoration. And I was thinking about the illustration about an old muscle car. And one of my favorites is a 69 Dodge Charger, like they had in the General Lee, the Duke's Hazard. I just have always liked that car. Just loved it ever since I was a little kid. And I got to thinking about it, and I was thinking about how that, you know, sometimes as a mechanic or looking for something like that, you drive around, and you start scouring the ads, and you start looking for the particular type of car that you want. Yeah. And I was thinking about coming across that. Now, that car is about 50 years old. And let's just say you found that in a barn, and it was dilapidated. You walk in there, and the hood's up, the car's up on blocks, the wheels are off it, the doors are off it. The interior is completely gone. The only thing really left on the inside is a steering wheel. The shifter's gone. The trunk's up. But you know what it is. You know exactly what you're looking at. And you start to look that old car over, and you look at the leaf springs, and you're starting to understand really more and more what you're looking at. And you walk up to the VIN code, and you look at the VIN code, and you can tell it's an RT car. And you look at the VIN code again, and it has J in it. You could tell it was a Hemi car. But you look at it in its dilapidated state, and you see what it could be. And you see what it could be. And you get a 5-gallon bucket, you get in there, it doesn't have a door, so you just don't worry about it. You put your 5-gallon bucket in there, you put your foot where the clutch is at, you put your hand on the steering wheel, and you're seeing what it could be. And that's the way Christ is in our life. He looks at your life and he wants to restore you. Like that guy, that mechanic does with that old car. He wants to bring you back to life. He sees the present state of where you're at, but he sees what you could be. He sees that old car with a brand new paint job. He sees that old car with a brand new engine. He sees that old car with that racist striper on the back end saying, this is what I can do in your life. Christ wants to restore your soul tonight. He wants to bring that love and that peace and that joy. But will you let him tonight? As every head is bowed and every eye is closed in reverence to God, we're talking about love tonight, and we're talking about restoration. What do you have need of in this service? Where are you at in God? I want to ask you a very serious question, a very straightforward question. If you died tonight, would you make it to heaven?
You say, brother, that's very straight. But it's a reality of life. Because each and every one of us is going to stand before God someday and have to give an account. And God's going to say, what happened here? Or what happened there? We're going to have to give an account of our life. So as you examine your life and you examine your soul, where are you? Do you need to be saved? Do you need to be born again? Christ is here to meet that need. Christ is here to put that love and that joy and that peace back in your heart. And as the sisters begin to play, how about it tonight? Where are you at in your life? Let's all find a place to pray. Pray.
I thought that number one would surely be me. I thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding.
Lord, I can't even walk. Lord.
can't do anything without Jesus. Thank God tonight for his restoring power, for all that he's doing within our hearts and our lives. It takes Jesus as we yield ourselves before him daily, as we decrease so that he may increase. Heavenly Father, continue to walk with us. Help us. Continue to keep our hand in your hand. Thank you, Jesus. This time I like Brother Otto, could you close in prayer tonight? You is our prayer. We'll see you back here Tuesday.